Hello and welcome to a new episode of The Ninif Experts. Today we are with our scientific director Christophe Cazaban to discuss about infectious bronchitis disease. So, welcome Christophe.
Thank you, Marco.
So today we want to discuss with him a little bit about the virus and the infection, how is the interaction between the virus and the bird, and of course, what's the difference between different strains? How we can categorize the strains, how some information, we want to go a little bit deeper on the virus to really understand this point on the infection bronchitis disease. So the first question for you to start, Christophe, would be, can you tell us a little bit about the virus itself? What's the characteristics of the virus?
So yes, thank you for this question, Marco. And I think it's very important first to clarify some points related to COVID-19. Because as you know, infectious bronchitis virus is a coronavirus like COVID-19 virus. So we are facing regularly questions about the classification or the similarity of these two viruses. So I would like to make it very clear from the right beginning that COVID-19 together like SARS or MERS, belongs to the group of the beta coronavirus, whereas infectious bronchitis virus belongs to the group of the gamma coronaviruses. So these are actually two completely different groups of coronaviruses. So now to answer more specifically about your question, I do believe that infectious bronchitis or IB is probably one of the most widely spread disease around the world, since every country with poultry production is facing infectious bronchitis somehow due to the high contagiosity of this virus that is present in all continents, in all latitudes, cold climates, warm climates, all year long. So it's very important poultry pathogen today.
After, we are going to discuss a little bit about how the virus changes or what kind of virus we can have, different strains. But first, I would like to ask you about the interaction between the virus and the bird. So can you disclose to us a little bit about the clinical signs or the interaction between the virus and the bird, an infection and these kind of things?
What's important to stress is that this virus has several tropisms in such a way that it can infect different parts of the body. So that's why in terms of symptomatology, it's quite variable. So to give you a first example, and what is quite standard for IB, is to infect the respiratory system. And just to illustrate, I took for you an illustrative picture showing what a normal trachea looks like. Here, this is even the mucosa of the trachea, to stress the importance of the ciliary cilia on that border that play a critical role in preventing the entrance of any pathogens deeper into the respiratory system. So in case of bronchitis infection, these cilia are completely destroyed due to the specific activity of this virus to kill the cells that are at the roots of these cilia. So you can imagine that if a bird is provided with this type of mucosa of the trachea, it's being much more prone to secondary infection, to different types of respiratory disease like air sacculitis, pneumonia, and so on and so forth. I'd like to stress at this stage the difference between bronchitis and laryngotracheitis, if you allow me this small comment here, because they may look quite similar in terms of tracheitis, basically. However, with IB, what we can observe in the lumen of the trachea is an overexpression of mucus due to this inflammation, which is presented in a kind of sticky material. Whereas with ILT, so infectious laryngotracheitis virus, we are much more dealing with a hemorrhage. With bronchitis, is inflammation. With ILT, it's hemorrhage, meaning that fibrinogen is entering into the trachea and it will turn into fibrin. So that's why, as you can see here on the picture, the inside of the lumen will rather look like a kind of solid, dry, cheesy-like material. So I just would like to stress this quite easy to remember difference between these two diseases. So this was related to the respiratory part, and this is obviously one of the major issues related to infectious bronchitis. Another critical aspect of this virus is the ability to infect kidneys. And here on the screen, you can see how the normal kidney can turn into completely swollen kidneys filled with urate crystals. And you can imagine that this bird is totally unable to withdraw water from the as it should be. So as a result, you end up with a very wet litter and very dirty birds and dirty environment due to a kind of flushing of the birds. So it's not diarrhea. Mm-hmm. It's very much wet material that is excreted by these birds. Lastly, and this is another very, very critical aspect of this virus, is the ability to infect the reproductive system. So in females, it turns into abnormality in eggs, so both in terms of quantity, so you are facing egg drops, as well as in quality. And this virus is very well known for affecting the quality of the shell. So shell-less eggs or ringed eggs or pale eggs, as well as the inner quality of the eggs with a very watery albumen. I would like also to stress that males can also be infected in terms of the reproductive tract, since orchitis are also described in case of IB infection. So as a result, you can imagine we are facing a loss of fertility. So in a nutshell, a virus that is really capable to induce plenty of different clinical signs, and there is no any single one that I would say is pathognomonic for this virus.
Regarding these clinical signs, can we do a differentiation according to the age of infection? Are we going to have variation?
Well, I would say that any age is susceptible to IB. Of course, the younger the infection, probably the most critical will be the consequences, just because of the relative immaturity of the immune system of the bird. And for instance, the famous false layer syndrome is well known for being actually due to a very early infection of the young pullet, let's say less than 10 days of age, by some specific strains of IBV. And that may go unnoticed, whereas you notice it much later when they enter into lay, where basically these birds don't lay. So this is a very critical issue. And again, I would say that any single age is prone to infection. Of course, the older the bird, hopefully the more vaccine is going to receive, so it's going to be more protected, so more immune, so there will be less likely infection. But a late infection is still possible, including during production. It's still possible, definitely.
Okay. You mentioned about the differentiation, that's really critical point, between different respiratory disease as infectious bronchitis and laryngotracheitis. How do you perceive the interaction between respiratory disease in the same bird? Not just these two, but other respiratory diseases.
That's a very important point, Marco, and really we have to stress this, since we do believe that every single pathogen is coming alone and doing its nasty job on the side. No, in most of the cases, I would say, we are dealing with co-infections. That can be either two viruses together, one virus, one bacterium, two bacteria, mycoplasmas there. Of course, environment plays a critical role there. So if you've got too high ammonia levels, for instance, it will definitely impact the resistance of the bird. But we do know that especially bronchitis virus with H9, low pathogenic avian influenza virus, are a very frequent cofactors of complicated respiratory disease in different parts of the world, with a definite aggravation, I would say, or higher outcome of the pathogenic results as compared to each virus taken alone. So there is a kind of bad synergy when these two viruses come together, yes.
So we discussed about the interaction of the virus. That's essential to understand, it's really important. But we know as well that the virus can change, and we have several mutations, have several variations creating variants of IBV. Can you explain to us why we have these mutations?
So indeed, this virus is really creating us some issues and some headache, since it's able to mutate quite extensively. And indeed, we do know now that these mutations or these changes can be done according to two different ways, I would say. The first of them is called the recombination, where actually in case of a combined infection of the same organism, of the same chicken, by two different viruses, these viruses can actually, or during the replication of the virus, the polymerase is going through what we call a template switching. So it's a little bit complicated word, just to illustrate that it's going to translate the first part of the RNA of a given virus, but then jump to the other virus and translate the rest of the RNA. So as a result, you will end up with a kind of chimeric new virus that will get some parts of the ancestor A, let's say, and some parts of the ancestor B. The other way of changes, which is probably more easy to understand, is the point mutations, meaning that in a given virus replication, which should be theoretically a kind of clonal multiplication, it's not clonal at all, because the polymerase is doing some mistakes. So in such a way that there are in a localized positions, some changes, some mutations, just due to a mistake of this translation. So we can imagine that probably most of these mutations are abortive. However, some of them, like COVID-19 actually, some of them end up into a kind of competitive advantage towards higher contagiosity, higher resistance whatsoever. So that's why we are getting new viruses that are popping up from time to time.
Okay, and how we can categorize the avian infection bronchitis?
So that's also a subject of a headache. And indeed, there has been currently a kind of I would say, agreement or consensus among experts around the world to categorize them into genotypes and lineages. So just to give you just a few information about that, the critical part of the virus is the spike protein, and especially the S1. And by sequencing this S1 protein, we are able to compare among different strains in order to see whether they fall into the same group or they are in a totally different groups. So these experts set some criteria of closeness, or let's say percentage of homology or variation, to put them into different lineages within the same genotype or into a new genotype. However, this is still regarded as a little bit academic, perhaps, and what is still very much used as of today by, let's say, common vets in the field, etc., is the traditional method, which was to call these groups by the names, like 793B or QX or variant 2. And that's what is represented here in this so-called bubble tree, which is perhaps somehow easier to understand. Namely, every single color represents a group. So just the size of the bubble represents the amount of strains that have been deposited into gene bank that belongs to that group. So it doesn't matter, whereas it shows that this group is more important or less important. It's not like that. It's just the amount of strains. And it also shows the ones that are somehow close to each other and the ones that are very far from each other.
Should we expect a different interaction between the virus and the bird, and even different clinical signs between different groups?
I would say initially, or in the past, the common sense was to think that some strains have more tropism to the kidney. Some others have more tropism to the respiratory system. Some others to the oviduct. The more we study, the more we dig, the more we investigate, the more we find that actually, even the same strain, or let's say the same group of strains, is capable to infect different organs. We cannot really say any longer that it's very specific to the kidney or to the respiratory system.
So, Christophe, and to close our conversation today, from what we discussed, what would you like to highlight in the infection bronchitis?
So what I'd like to highlight is a few points. First of all, this disease is absolutely everywhere. It's just about a matter of diagnosing it. In some places around the world, it's not regarded as a main issue. However, I'm convinced that it is a major issue, either on its own or as a cofactor with other pathogens, like H9, like mycoplasma, like E. coli, like Newcastle, you name it. So it's very much about the role of the vet who knows the farm, who knows the history of a given flock, to ask for a proper diagnosis in front of a given clinical case, and to think broadly, not only one single pathogen, but to ask the lab to investigate in a broad spectrum so that he or she will have a better idea of what's going on.
So, Christophe, thank you for one more really valuable conversation and discussion. I hope you enjoy, as I enjoy this conversation, and keep with us. See you.